Hello, Internet! Welcome to Game Theory, where today we're talking about dinosaurs, which means I have one piece of advice. Hold on to your butts. But seriously, after 4 years of covering everything from quantum physics to gemology, we finally have a reason to talk about every kid's favorite topic, thunder lizards. And not just dinos, but LEGO dinos. Now, way back in the day as a youngin, a mat baby, a tot pat, perhaps, I loved dinosaurs. How big and powerful they were, how cool they looked, but most of all, I was fascinated by the science behind them. Yes, I was a nerd, even back then. And if you can remember back to the 90s, simpler time of neon shirts and pogs, Jurassic Park featured scientists who were able to extract dino DNA from a mosquito captured in a piece of amber. From that starting point, they were able to bring these titanic lizards back from the dead. So cool! But now Jurassic World takes it one step further. We see that the scientists not only were able to rebirth the dinosaurs, but then cross the DNA together, creating super smart, super fast, super deadly dinosaur hybrids. And no, we're not talking about hybrids like that Prius you got parked out front. We're talking your pet iguana on steroids. And so why am I talking about this on Game Theory? Well, outside of shamelessly plugging our new channel, Film Theorist, click here to check it out, it's because the video game based on the movie, LEGO Jurassic World, allows you to participate in the process you see in the films. Find amber pieces, extract dino DNA, and cross together some super creatures, like a velociraptor with triceratops horns. At last, a Jurassic game that perfectly simulates the movies, allowing me to create dinosaurs without any regard for the horrible ecological consequences and mass destruction that will inevitably follow when my ultra dinos escape. Video games! Anyway, creating dino genetic Frankensteins in LEGO Jurassic World is a cool concept, in theory, in game theory. Sorry. Force a habit. It's cool in theory, but come on. This is purely science fiction, right? We couldn't possibly create dino hybrids today, could we? Could we? You know that if I'm asking the question, the answer is gonna be pretty mind-blowing, so in the words of Sam Jackson, hold on to your butts. Wait, I already used that once this episode. Clever girl? Yeah, that's another quote from the movie, but it doesn't really apply here. Let's start by picking apart the science. Genetic hybridization. Crossing together DNA strands to create a super-powered monster. Sounds like either movie magic or ultra-futuristic, but actually it's kinda old news. People have intentionally been doing genetic hybridization for years. In fact, you might have one of these genetic creations in your home right now. Want a dog that looks like a poodle but isn't super high maintenance? Meet the cockapoo. Cockapoo. Oh, it's funny just saying it. Meet the cockapoo, a disturbingly adorable cross between a poodle and a cocker spaniel. Any of you have a non-allergenic cat? Genetic hybridization at work. Or a whale with the intelligence of a dolphin. The walpin, I guess it would be. There are genetic hybrids all over the world that have happened either accidentally in the wild or to create animals that are cuter, bigger, smaller, live longer, or don't give me allergies. The key to creating a genetic hybrid is having two species with similar enough genetics that they match up to create a viable animal. So what about dinosaurs? They're all just big lizards, right? Well, kind of. To figure out whether dino splicing is actually possible, we need to take a closer look at one of the dinosaur's closest modern relatives. Nope. You would think so, right? Yeah, now you're just... Wait, really? Believe it or not, the chicken is actually one of the closest descendants we have to prehistoric dinosaurs, even closer than alligators and lizards. Mind-blowing, right? And get this, in the modern world, it also has one of the genomes that we know the most about, mostly because we've been manipulating its genetics for years to create bigger, meatier buckets of extra crispy, original recipe fried chicken. So, say you're a geneticist and you want to create a chicken with bigger wings. You have two options. The first would be to get your chicken to do some bicep curls, but poultry-sized barbell sets cost a breast and a thigh, so you're best going with your second option, mapping out the genome of the chicken. If you'll recall from 6th grade biology class, DNA is a long string of coded information that gets translated into everything in your body, from your height to your skin color to that weird mole on your right butt cheek. I'm sure at least one of you right now just went, "How did he know?" Oh, I know. I know. Once they figure out what part of the genome gets translated into wing size, they compare the DNA of chickens with different sized wings to find the gene producing the beefiest wing size of the bunch. Or, I guess it wouldn't be beefiest, it would be chickeniest wing size. That's just weird. Anyway, the gene is chopped out, copied, and then put into a DNA vector. Technically, it's a virus. Like the virus that you get when you have the common cold, but instead of giving the chicken a runny nose, this virus gives the chicken wings like a 747. No joke! They use this DNA vector to inject the better genes into the egg cells of the chicken so that when the egg hatches, it's genetically guaranteed to have the right genes. As you can imagine, this process is difficult and complicated, even if you're just changing one feature the chicken had already. But what about crazy stuff? It's one thing to create bigger slices of meat, seedless watermelons, or hypoallergenic dogs, but what we see in LEGO Jurassic World with dinosaurs having all sorts of weird mixes, that should take things to a whole new level, right? Well, maybe not. In principle, anything that lives has genes, and whether you think it's a good idea or not to mess with animals' DNA, science has come up with some amazing hybrids that might convince you that LEGO Jurassic World is more sci and less fi. Back in the early 2000s, agriculture scientists Jeffrey Turner and Paul Ballard were studying, you know, agricultural stuff, I guess. I don't know what agriculture scientists do. But they noticed that the material used by spiders to make their webs had some pretty remarkable properties. Spider silk is an incredibly strong material, resistant to heat and degrading, and is far lighter than most other strong materials we use every day. It's one of those things that can be made into everything from artificial tendons in your body to bulletproof vests thinner and stronger than Kevlar after being properly treated. But the thing is, to actually make anything useful out of the silk, you have to harvest it from the spiders. Obviously, that would require a ton of waiting and like a million horror movies worth of spiders. Oh god, I can't even think about it. These guys were able to avoid making the scariest farm in history by isolating silk-making genes from a golden orb weaver spider and insert those silk genes into a goat. Into a goat, I kid you not. Kids with spider genes. Get it, kids and kids? Never mind. This is wild. The results? Goats that produced both milk and spider silk. Whether you think this is cool or actually just kinda icky, it's one of a whole slew of examples where genes from totally different genomes were combined to create animals with extra features and special powers. Want a glow-in-the-dark cat? You can have one with the jelly cat, a cross between a cat and a jellyfish. How about a mouse that can chirp like a bird? Try the singing mouse. And those are just two of my favorites. The list of animals with bizarre superpowers just goes on. But now, that brings us back to the dinosaurs. Based on our research, it seems like combining dinosaur DNA would be a pretty simple process, right? I mean, if we can do it with a goat and a spider, this should be a pretty open and shut case, right? Theory over, super satisfying. Well, not really. It turns out that when it comes to creating super customized hybrid dinos, it's not the technology holding us back, it's the archaeology. Remember, in order to combine DNA, you have to map the genome. You have to basically know where these biological bricks go and what they do before you start mixing and matching parts from two different dinos. And that's a problem when you start talking about cells that are 60 million years old. I mean, think about it. We just sequenced the human genome like 12 years ago, and there are a few billion living examples of that walking around to test from. That's like genome mapping on easy mode, but getting actual viable samples of dino DNA? That's like ultra insanity hard mode. We're talking 60 million years ago. Million years ago, all the cells that would have contained usable DNA are literally turned to dust. Dust in the wind, like that Kansas song. Don't you play it, Earl. Stop it. We don't have enough money to license that. Come on. And that's only considering we want to find one cell and then figure out which ones do the super cool things like produce razor sharp jaws versus the ones that do the lame stuff like provide an extra bone in the foot or something. The genes that do that totally got the short end of the genetic stick. So, believe it or not, creating a hybrid super dino like a Triceratops rex would be genetically possible if we were somehow able to find the basic dinosaur cells.
2003, the world finds dinosaur cells.
Talk about convenient timing.
That year in Montana, a team was excavating T-Rex skeletons way out in the middle of nowhere. It was such a remote area of the wilderness that they actually had to airlift bones out by helicopter. But while they were trying to get the bones out, a T-Rex thigh bone broke in two. At first, they thought it was terrible, until they took a closer look, and they found strange patterns inside the bone. Soft tissue, still left after 68 million years. They couldn't believe what they had found, but it got better, as upon further investigation, they found dinosaur blood vessels. Inside there were tiny dinosaur cells, becoming one of the most exciting dinosaur digs ever.
Wait, so according to a video from a kid at the Australian Zoo, Robert Irwin... Wait, that's the crocodile hunter's son! According to Robert Irwin's research, it would seem like we might be able to find the DNA we need to make this a possibility.
That's right.
Is it just me or are these videos talking to me?
Even though we haven't found a lot of dino DNA yet, that dig showed the world that even millions of years later, we're still able to find what it takes to maybe one day build our own dinosaurs. And believe it or not, we might not even need a full dinosaur because of, you guessed it, the chicken. After studying dinosaur fossils and comparing them to bird DNA, scientists have found that some of the dinosaur-like genes in birds are turned off in their modern form. If there were a way to turn those genes back on, scientists could actually bring back some of the dinosaur traits that chickens have hidden away, or just given a chicken a dino mouth instead of a beak. Sound like a stretch? Think again. It's already been done. Pretty incredible, right, MatPat?
How did an embedded video just talk to me and know my name? Internet is a weird place, man. But I guess you can't doubt the Australian dino genius. So yeah, getting the DNA might be really, really difficult, but research shows it's certainly not impossible. Chickens with dino noses, bones with 60 million year old cells hidden inside? Huh, so what's the verdict then? Well, when I started researching for this episode, I thought for sure that LEGO Jurassic World would be completely disproven. But in fact, I was pretty shocked at how much progress we've made towards actually being able to create a hybrid dinosaur. We have the technology, we have modern descendants of dinosaurs to work with, and someday we may even have enough original DNA to make a new dinosaur a new reality. Now, if only electric fence technology would advance fast enough to effectively pen in these things, we would be golden. But hey, that's just a theory. A game theory. Thanks for watching. Welcome back to the Super Amazing End Card Tournament, where this week the question is, well, a bizarre one, actually. We're taking two hybrids and deciding which dino wins the day. Who would win in a fight? A Lego T-Rex with Triceratops horns, or a squad of Lego Raptors with Stegosaurus tails? I cannot wait to see you guys try and debate this one out in the comments. Click on one to choose, or vote in the comments, and next time I'll let you know who you all thought won. And hey, if this video got you excited about romping through LEGO Jurassic World, click the link in the description to order your own copy. To be 100% transparent with you guys, this video was sponsored by the game, and it's thanks to them that I was able to partner with Robert Irwin, which was incredibly cool. But let me remind you guys right here and now that whenever any of us theorists do a video supported by a company, the final findings are always strictly our own. It's something we pride ourselves on, and in this particular case, if I didn't enjoy LEGO games or couldn't say what I wanted, I wouldn't have done the video. So rest assured, our integrity isn't for sale, and I want to make sure that you guys know that. Seriously, LEGO games are just fun and cute, and dinosaurs are awesome. Tot-Pat is so jelly right now, and by jelly, I mean jealous. I just used jelly as an abbreviation to show how stupid that word actually sounds. But in the meantime, if you'll excuse me, I've got a strange hankering for some buffalo chicken wings. Huh, wonder why.